Greetings, everyone, in the name of Jesus our Lord, on this fourth Sunday of Easter, also known as Good Shepherd Sunday. Our readings for today are focusing upon Jesus, who is our Good Shepherd, who has laid down his life for the sheep. And it is my honor and privilege to be here with you today. Just a few of us here in the sanctuary who are essential for what we do here, as well as those of you who are on Facebook Live. Welcome to you all. Please do me a huge favor, fill out the attendance card, which is marking that you're here. Give us a thumbs up, give us a hi, whatever, in the comments section. Also, if you have prayer requests, please note those as well, and then in the coming days, we will do our best to include those in our prayers. Have a couple of real fast announcements. One is I want to remind you all that every morning during the week, we have morning devotions at 9 o'clock, Monday through Friday. You meet with me here on this channel. Why is this moving by itself? We meet with me here on this channel and for morning devotions. Also, I want to remind you of the National Day of Prayer that is coming up this Thursday. We're going to be praying for healing, we're going to be praying for repentance, we're going to be praying for spiritual awakening, and so if you're on our email list, I'll be sending out some materials by Tuesday, so watch your email inbox on the National Day of Prayer. If you don't have email, let me know, and I will see what I can do to hand deliver those to you. The other item I want to announce is our Bible study on the book of Romans. We are still in chapter 6. We'll probably be in chapter 6 until Christmas on the rate we're going. But nonetheless, I want to invite you all to come and be a part of that. We meet on Thursdays at 10:30 on a Zoom video conference. And again, if you would like the... why is this doing this crazy thing? If you would like to be a part of that, please, if you don't have the access code, let me know and I'll make sure you get it. All right. Evidently, this thing does not like me doing announcements. So we will just get on with it. It's good to be with you today. Christ is risen. He is risen indeed. Hallelujah. And we gather together today in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Blessed be God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. And blessed be his kingdom, now and forever. Hallelujah! Christ is risen. The Lord is risen indeed. Hallelujah. Let us sing.
Savior, like a shepherd, lead us. Much we need thy tender pleasant pastures, feed us, for our use your folds prepare. Blessed Jesus, thou hast bought us, thine we are. Blessed Jesus, you have bought us. Blessed Jesus.
Christ, risen Master and triumphant Lord, we come to you in sorrow for our sins and confess to you our weakness and unbelief. We have lived by our own strength and not by the power of your resurrection. In your mercy, forgive us. Lord, hear us and help us. We have lived by the light of our own eyes, as faithless and not believing. In your mercy, forgive us. Lord, hear us and help us. We have lived for this world alone and doubting our home in heaven. In your mercy, forgive us. Lord, hear us and help us. May the God of love and power forgive you and free you from your sins, heal and strengthen you by his Spirit, and raise you to new life in Christ our Lord. Amen.
Be with you and also with you. Let us pray. Lord, help us to trust in you alone, because you've promised that your goodness does in fact lead us home. In your mercy, Father, you have awakened from death the shepherd of your sheep. So grant us by your Holy Spirit that when we hear the voice of our shepherd, that we may know him who calls each of us by name and follow him where he leads, and that sin and death may never pluck us out of your hand. We pray this through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and who reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. First reading for today is recorded in Acts chapter 2, beginning with verse 42. This is following the day of Pentecost, and after 3,000 people came to know Christ and were baptized, and Luke writes, continues, and they devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and the fellowship, to the breaking of bread and to the prayers. And awe came upon every soul, and many wonders and signs were being done through the apostles. And all who believed were together and had all things in common. And they were selling their possessions and belongings and distributing the proceeds to all as any had need. And day by day, attending the temple together and breaking bread in their homes, they received their food with glad and generous hearts, praising God and having favor with all the people. And the Lord added to their number day by day those who were being saved. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Our epistle reading is from 1 Peter chapter 2, beginning with verse 19, which is also our text for today's message. St. Peter writes, "For this is a gracious thing, when, mindful of God, one endures sorrow while suffering unjustly. For what credit is it if when you sin, you are beaten for it, you endure? But if when you do good and suffer for it, you endure, this is a gracious thing in the sight of God. For to this you have been called, because Christ suffered for you, leaving you an example so that you might follow in his steps. He committed no sin, neither was deceit found in his mouth. When he was reviled, he did not revile in return. When he suffered, he did not threaten, but continued entrusting himself to him who judges justly. He himself bore our sins in his body on the tree, that we might die to sin and live to righteousness. By his wounds you have been healed. For you were straying like sheep, but now you have returned to the shepherd and overseer of your souls." The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Our holy gospel is written according to St. John, the 10th chapter. Glory to thee, O Christ. Please rise. Jesus says, "Truly, truly, I say to you, he who does not enter the sheepfold by the door, but climbs in another way, that man is a thief and a robber. But he who enters by the door is the shepherd of the sheep. To him the gatekeeper opens, the sheep hear his voice, and he calls his own sheep by name and leads them out. When he has brought out all his own, he goes before them, and the sheep follow him, for they know his voice. A stranger they will not follow, but they will flee from him, for they do not know the voice of strangers." This figure of speech Jesus used with them, but they did not understand what he was saying to them. So Jesus again said to them, "Truly, truly, I say to you, I am the door of the sheep. All who come before me are thieves and robbers, but the sheep did not listen to them. I am the door. If anyone enters by me, he will be saved and will go in and out and find pasture. The thief comes only to steal and to kill and destroy. I came that they might have life and have it abundantly. The Gospel of the Lord. Praise to thee, O Christ. Let us confess our common Christian faith. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and of all things visible and invisible, and in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, begotten of his Father before all worlds, God of God, light of light, very God of very God, begotten, not made, being of one substance with the Father, by whom all things were made, who for us men and for our salvation came down from heaven and was incarnate by the Holy Spirit of the Virgin Mary and was made man, and was crucified also for us under Pontius Pilate. He suffered and was buried, and the third day he rose again according to the Scriptures and ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of the Father. And he will come again with glory to judge both the living and the dead, whose kingdom will have no end. And I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son together is worshipped and glorified, who spoke by the prophets. And I believe in one holy Christian and apostolic church. I acknowledge one baptism for the remission of sins, and I look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. You may be seated as we sing our hymn of the day. Dear friends in Christ, grace to you and peace from God our Father and from our risen Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Dear friends, we are a kind of people who love good examples. We love examples of people who are very productive today. I mean, who is it that we are encouraged to emulate in our own lives? Who are some people that come to mind? Political leaders? Maybe not. Military leaders, perhaps military heroes, maybe some sports figures, achievers in fields of science and technology. Who are we encouraged to emulate? Maybe accomplished artists, entertainers. But there are problems with emulating people of this earth, people of this world. Because you see, with any figure who has made a template or a model for our lives, there is bound to be failure. As we have often discovered, those who look good in the public eye are often deeply flawed in their moral failures. I mean, do you really want to hold up as an example a successful business person who is convicted of embezzlement, or a popular political figure whose life is marred by sexual infidelity? I mean, there are no perfect examples. And even with the best examples, these men and women whose lives do appear to be wholesome and without public defect, there is a problem. You see, they seem to set the bar so high that we can never, ever measure up. In today's text, Peter speaks of another example. He speaks of one who is categorically different than any other role model or hero that you might think of within the world that we know today. Peter commends to us the Good Shepherd, Jesus Christ. He is an example, but he is also so much more than an example. You see, he is the Savior who suffered for our sins and was raised from death to give life to unruly and straying sheep. Sheep who are unfaithful, sheep who steal, sheep who stumble and fall. So this morning, we're going to focus our minds and our hearts on this Good Shepherd. You see, our Good Shepherd is the only example in the midst of our suffering. Have you ever suffered from doing the right thing? Suffered from doing good? Peter says this, but if you suffer for doing good, this is commendable before God. If you suffer for doing good, this is commendable before God. Peter's words to the Christian slaves must have upset them. That's who he's writing to, a bunch of Christian slaves. Several times in his epistle, he states that painful treatment is bound to happen, not only at the hands of their masters, but by others as well. In all fairness, it just doesn't seem right, even to us today. Who would have thought, who would have thunk it, as I like to say sometimes, that Christians in America would be persecuted? But it's starting to happen. You see, being good and doing good should result in blessing. It should result in reward, right? Well, an old historian who's dead, is also an atheist, he said this. His name was H.G. Wells. He complained that Christians were basically selfish, forever looking for God's favor. They serve him, but not for nothing, he said. You see, living a decent life in word and deed has its consequences, my friends. And many of these consequences are not desirable. One cannot separate the wetness from water or the softness from feathers. Psalm chapter 1 specifically states, "Blessed is the man whose delight is in the law of the Lord, and whatever he does, he prospers." but in reality, not always. Just look at Job, for example. He was blameless and upright. He feared God and he shunned evil. But Satan was permitted to unhitch the goodness of Job to the prosperity that resulted from it, only to show the tempter to be wrong. Even though Job lost his family, he lost his property, and he lost his own health. So when we do good and suffer for it, what is our response? Well, maybe we're tempted to seek revenge. Sweet revenge, huh? To get even. Well, Peter says this in our text today, "For this you have been called, because Christ also suffered for you, leaving you an example that you might follow in his steps. When he was reviled, he did not revile in return. While suffering, he uttered no threats." Certainly the abuse Christians suffer today, and especially those Christian slaves in the days of Peter, must not have been taken lightly. Those slaves in Peter's day must have really have been wound up around the axle, full of consternation, thinking, "I became a Christian and I thought my problems would go away," and they didn't. You see, the temptation to lie in wait, the temptation to plot a revenge, could hardly be absent. Peter knew all about that. The scene in Gethsemane is, if you recall, is where Peter drew his sword and cut off the soldier's ear, the soldier Malchus. And I'm sure as he was penning these words, that incident was all too familiar to him. Nor did the other disciples find it easy to turn the other cheek when they were abused. When they went to the Samaritan village to ready things for their master, they were not welcomed. And if you recall, James and John asked Jesus, "Lord, do you want us to call down fire from heaven to destroy them?" And for this vengeful spirit, Jesus found it necessary to rebuke his brothers. Even Joseph's brothers, who had sold him into slavery, were expecting the worst when they recognized him finally years later as the all-powerful prime minister of Egypt, the second in command of the most powerful king in all the world. But his forgiveness and subsequent actions to take care of them and their families stand out as one of the most magnificent accounts of undeserved mercy in the Old Testament. So Peter introduces the mistreated slaves to the example of Jesus Christ, who is merciful, who came and forgave sins, even towards those who abused him, a most striking declaration of love. And not only were they to stifle threats of retaliation, they were to take positive steps in dealing with their tormentors. I mean, listen to this from chapter 3, verses 9 through 12. This will be skipped in the pericope next week, but I want you to hear it. "Do not return evil for evil, insult for insult, but instead bless others, because you were called to inherit a blessing. For the one who wants to love life and see good days must keep his tongue from evil and his lips from uttering deceit. And he must turn away from evil and do good. He must seek peace and pursue it. For the eyes of the Lord are upon the righteous, and his ears are open to their prayer. But the Lord's face is against those who do evil." Isn't this, unfortunately, is not how it works in our world today. In these days, in our country, even in our world, people have been confined to home. They've been confined to rules and regulations. Many are complaining of a tyrannical government because of this current pandemic that we're in. The citizenry is becoming very, very unsettled. Or as I like to say, the natives are becoming restless. People are trying to do the right thing, but sometimes they overstep, perhaps. I just heard of a brother pastor, a colleague in ministry of mine, in his parish. He sought guidance and permission from his local leaders to begin holding church services. And what happened as a result? Instead of getting praises and thanks, he started receiving death threats and all kinds of scorn, called every name in the book that would even make a sailor blush, because he dared to open up God's house with permission from the local government leaders, mind you, but from others. Unfortunately, people don't act in ways that are becoming. Even Christians don't act in ways that are becoming. But there is a better way. Peter says this in verse 24, that he, that's Jesus, he himself bore our sins in his body on the tree. During World War I, the German citizens who were living in England were directed by their Kaiser to join the German army in Paris. They were to travel to Paris, put on the German uniform. And while one of the citizens was wondering what to do, he spoke about the situation to an acquaintance of his. And one thing led to another until he came up with a very, very large sum of money if the acquaintance would take his place. Can you imagine that? World War I, if his acquaintance would take his place. And so what do you think happened? His friend accepted the offer. He took the money and he went to Paris, and he joined the German troops. Only a few days after his arrival, he was killed by a French shell, a French bomb. Back in England, the man who paid him to take his place reasoned the following, in the eyes of the law, I am dead. Germany now has no more claim on me. But dear friends, in like manner, Jesus Christ, our good shepherd, became your substitute. And as we heard last Sunday, he paid the full price for your sins through his precious blood, by his very own life. We are no longer slaves to sin. We are no longer slaves by fear of death. We are no longer captive by the devil. We are no longer in bondage to sin, unable to free ourselves, because Jesus has set us free. Hallelujah. The author of Hebrews says this, therefore, since the children of flesh share in flesh and blood, he likewise shared in their humanity, so that through death he could destroy the one who holds the power of death, that is the devil, and set free those who are held in slavery all their lives by the fear of death. Dear friends in Christ, this is talking about Jesus' substitutionary work. And it is so well typified in the account of Abraham and his son Isaac. You remember the story? God tells Abraham to take his only son, whom he loves, and take him to Mount Moriah and sacrifice him on the altar as a burnt offering. So what does Abraham do? He takes his son. They go on a journey with some servants. They get to after a couple of days, they get to the base of the mountain, and he tells the servants to wait here. He says, while I and the boy go up on the mountain to worship the Lord, he puts the wood for the sacrifice on his boy's back, makes him carry this wood up the mountain. The boy Isaac asking his dad, Father, here's the wood for the fire, and here's the fire, but where's the sacrifice? And Abraham said, God will provide. So he gets up there, and he builds an altar. He arranges the wood on the altar. He binds up his only son, Isaac, and he lays him upon the wood, the firewood. And just as he is about ready to take his knife and plunge it into his son's chest, he is halted by a word from the Lord, and Isaac is set free. Because a ram was caught in the thicket and the ram was used as the sacrifice, as the substitute in place of his son. The similarities, dear friends, are striking. God the Father offered his only son, whom he loved, in our place. And having been released from the guilt and the burden of sin and all of its consequences, we are still living in a world that is hostile towards God's people. One glaring example I shared a minute ago, people are prevented from worshiping, for gathering together in worship. Yes, there are good reasons why we need to be careful. But nevertheless, to call down death threats upon a pastor who got permission is beyond the pale. Here's what I want us all to remember. Because of our inheritance, the inheritance for which we wait, we will, having been raised with Christ, set our minds on the things above, not on earthly things. Since Christ suffered in his body, we arm ourselves with the same attitude, because he who has suffered in his body is done with sin. And as a result, we do not live the rest of our earthly lives for human evil desires, but rather for the will of God. Jesus Christ was put to death for your sin and was raised for your justification. And knowing that he loves us with such an everlasting love, even to the point of being given over to suffer death on the cross, we can now live as those who are conformed to his image, pressed, as painful as an image that is, pressed into the image of God. He is an example for the life of faith in the Father and the love for the neighbor. But even better, he is our shepherd who has rescued us, who has reconciled us to his Father, and even now, by his gospel, who is enlivening us by his Holy Spirit to live in him and for him. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. As we go to the Lord in prayer, I want to encourage you all. It is really hard this way, honestly, because we're all separated. But if you have prayer requests, truly, truly, I mean this sincerely, if you would let me know, I would love to pray for you, and I would love to add those to our prayers for the church, and add them to our prayer chain. So if you do have a prayer request, you can note, as I mentioned earlier, you can note it in the comment section below on Facebook, or you can send me a personal message or give me a phone call, and I'll be happy to include you in our prayers. So let us now pray for all the people of God in Christ Jesus and for all others according to their needs. Blessed Shepherd, you established your church with your sacrificial death and mighty resurrection. Grant us devotion that we may be able to live for you, that we would abide in you always, that we would abide in the teachings of the apostles and honor of the fellowship of the church. Guard us against all enemies of your word, and keep us in the care of your flock and staff forevermore. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Mighty Shepherd, you hold your hands, in your hands all the might of man, and you hold accountable those who govern your people. Grant us good government, good leaders, who will honor your purpose, protect your people, serve the cause of justice, and defend our liberty against all threats. Give them wisdom and moderation in their pandemic response. Lord, in your mercy. Loving Shepherd, you love the world enough to shed your blood, and you desire that all would be saved and come to the knowledge of the truth. Inspire and equip your church and her ministers to speak faithfully and boldly your word. Bless all those who serve us, who serve on your behalf, especially the doctors and the nurses and the emergency responders, the police, the firefighters, the paramedics. Bless especially those who are persecuted for the faith, who are suffering for the sake of good that honors you and is obedient to your word. We especially pray for other churches around our world, and especially in our nation, and the pastors who are trying to faithfully lead, shouldering many, many, many burdens. We pray, dear Lord, that you would surround them with a hedge of protection. Protect them, dear Lord, from the assaults of the evil one. Lord, in your mercy. Merciful Shepherd, your wounds are our healing, and your voice calls us to you in our time of need. Hear us on behalf of all those who are ill in body and mind, and give to those who grieve for those whom they love, and be with those whom death draws near. In particular, dear Lord, we remember in our prayers Barb Lynch, Jerry Esslinger's grandson, Kyle, along with his wife, Kira, who has complications to her pregnancy. We pray for the Madsen family and their grief. We also pray for Gary Blazer and David Blazer. We continue to pray for Muriel as she recovers from her surgery, as well as her daughter, Ruth. We also pray for Debbie, Angie's mother. We pray for Sharon, who was recently diagnosed with Parkinson's disease. We pray for Renee, who continues to recover from an auto accident, as well as those who are particularly vulnerable due to cancer treatments. Mary and Holly and Matt and Darcy and Titan and Linda, and those whom we name in our hearts at this time. Grant them healing according to your will, grace to sustain them in their day of trouble, and hope of a new and everlasting life to come. We also pray, dear Lord, for the unemployed and the distraught. Especially, Lord, we pray for Amber and her co-workers, that you would show yourself to be their provider. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Gracious Shepherd, you seek out those who have fallen, and you restore the sinner to repentance. So send forth your Holy Spirit to rekindle faith in the hearts of those who have fallen away from the truth, or who have been overcome by temptation and sin. Bring good from ill, and increase in all the hunger of your word, and a recognition of our need, that many may be gathered into your flock
when church doors do open wide once again. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Good Shepherd, you have not withheld anything from us. Instead, dear Lord, you emptied yourself fully upon the cross that we might be saved. Move our hearts to such devotion and teach us generosity that we may bring to you the tithes and the offerings of grateful hearts and serve our neighbor in need with the resources that you have supplied to us so abundantly. Lord, in your mercy. Good Shepherd, you set your table before us in the presence of our enemies. Hear us, because we are beset with so many false voices and tempted by so many false gospels. Help us all, dear Lord, to hear your voice and to abide safely in your word that remains forever. Equip us with your Holy Spirit that we may receive your body and blood with faith and with a repentant heart. Lord, in your mercy. O good Shepherd, we pray you to hear your sheep, to answer our prayers with mercy, granting us those things that are profitable for us and our salvation, and keeping us from all things harmful. For you live and you reign with the Father and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Now remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen.
And now, dear friends, may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. May the Lord look upon you with favor and grant you his peace. Amen.